Today, I want to discuss how enterprise architecture is a key instrument in improving the capabilities in your organization. So let's look at enterprise architecture in more detail. It has a broad scope, looking at enterprise-wide coherence between your strategy, business operations, and IT and other technology that supports this. It gives direction to the evolution of your enterprise by focusing on where you want to go and what you need to do to get there. Now, I consider business architecture an integral part of true enterprise architecture. The latter is not just enterprise-wide IT architecture. Now, one of the key notions in business and enterprise architecture is the capability concept. Business capabilities describe what the business does or is able to do. They don't describe how, where, or when the business does this, so they are independent from implementation details. That makes them relatively stable. For instance, an insurance company a century ago would have had many of the same capabilities as today, ranging from product development to insurance policy management and from processing insurance claims to asset management. Capabilities are realized by the people, processes, and technology of the enterprise. They are owned and defined by the business in business terms. And by the way, the business is an IT term for anything non-IT, so be careful with that. The typical way of depicting capabilities is in a capability map. Since capabilities are easily recognized by the business and relatively stable, such a map often becomes a shared language and a common backdrop for all kinds of analyses. Think, for instance, of a heat map showing the strategic importance of capabilities and the business continuity risk posed by obsolete technology that supports certain capabilities. Such a risk analysis is one example where you would use the relationships in your enterprise architecture between these capabilities, how strategically important they are, and how they are realized by people, processes, and systems, and additional information like lifecycle data about those systems. For many industries, there are common reference models that have a capability model at their heart. For instance, in finance, you have the BIAN model for banking, and I've worked with similar models for government and for higher education and for other sectors. Rather than defining your own capabilities from scratch, you can use such a reference model as a starting point. Moreover, you can also use this to compare and benchmark your capabilities and plan improvements. And this is where the planning part of capability-based planning kicks in. Of course, you will want to improve those capabilities where first there is a strategic interest, and second, they need an uplift because they are below par. For the first, it's common to classify your capabilities along dimensions such as supporting, core, and strategic or direction setting, business critical or not, or commodity versus differentiating. Capabilities that are core and differentiating are strategically the most important, whereas commodity non-core capabilities could perhaps be outsourced if they underperform. Moreover, the position of capabilities in the value streams of the enterprise is essential in investment decision-making. For instance, core capabilities that are involved in customer-facing, value-creating activities but do not perform as expected by those customers are prime candidates for improvement. The enterprise architecture that sits behind those capabilities helps you analyze where those improvements can and should be made, and what the dependencies are that you have to take into account. Now, ideally, your capabilities are relatively independent from each other, so you can involve and improve them on their own. Your architecture practice should support the minimization of these dependencies. For example, IT applications shared by many capabilities. Of course, there are other considerations like efficiency, but all too often I see architectures that were designed in the resource-constrained days of yore, where lots of dependencies are created because every capability depends on one single central department or one central system. That leads to problems when such a shared system needs to be changed or replaced to better support one capability, but that would impact many other areas where that change cannot be made so easily. So one size fits all may not be the best option for such a system. Sometimes it's better to support different capabilities with their own resources. That comes with its own architecture challenges, like a need to replicate and synchronize data between different systems. But in today's fast-changing environment, the higher speed of change you get from this may be more important than the cost savings from a centralized solution. This requires a well-considered trade-off between, in this case, efficiency and flexibility in your planning efforts. Making those trade-offs is, of course, a key job of architects. So in summary, enterprise architecture provides you with a coherent view on the realization of your business capabilities by the underlying resources and processes, and it links these capabilities to your business goals and strategic direction, and to the business model of the organization. It lets you pinpoint where investments in improvements should be made based on the importance for your business. And finally, it helps in realizing these capabilities in such a way that you can support and improve change in the enterprise, both in the short and in the longer term. Together, this gives you a clear line of sight between your strategy, business model, operating model, the implementation of that, and it lets you evolve and improve your enterprise in a smart way.